How have you been?
Very well, Pooja. How are you? Sorry to keep you waiting. I just received the link.
Oh, okay. Anyways, congratulations. Sab log seem to be watching Patal Lok, as Anushka rightly said.
Well, I do hope so. I think the lockdown does have its advantages, and that people seem to have time on hand. So I think they can watch it.
So how is the lockdown treating you?
It's gotten better, to be honest, Pooja. Things were pretty challenging to begin with. You know, I have a 2-year-old child. And I'm no longer terrified at the thought of my husband resuming work on Monday. Because then it'll be just me and the 2-year-old and the dogs. And, you know, I think in terms of support that we've been used to in our homes, Pooja, I feel that that's not going to be available to us either as an option or as a choice for some time to come.
Which is true.
I think this has been a great boot camp starting the... I mean, we've actually been on our own at home since the 18th. We even shut my production office on the 17th of March. So now close to 2 months that we've been sort of operating on our own. And I mean, some things have gotten better. So some things are still taking time. But yeah, the short answer is it's gotten better.
So what is the one thing you like about being indoors and the one thing you absolutely detest about being indoors?
I like everything about my present situation. I've, in my head, stopped fighting what I can't control a long time ago, not just because of the lockdown, which is probably also why I haven't been so disturbed by the lockdown mentally. And there's nothing I detest about being indoors. I think I'm grateful that I have everything that I want in my life indoors right now.
And you've been someone who has raised her voice and spoken about stuff ever since the lockdown was announced. What do you actually think is the need of the hour?
I think for us to be responsible citizens, I mean, we have to understand that India is a country of, you know, over 1.3 billion people. And there is only so much the government can do. And that is something we've got to be cognizant of. You know, A, we're a democracy. B, there are too many people. So the gap between what needs to be done and what can be done is always going to be there. Which is why individual affirmative action is really important in society. And I think all of us need to be more responsible, whether it's trying to support those who have no support in times like this, or it's just making sure that we do our roles in this entire spectrum to the best of our ability. I think that is really what the need of the hour is. I mean, demanding and asking for stuff is, I mean, come on, we're not a first world nation. And we shouldn't have first world expectations of our government without trying to be the dutiful citizens that first world nations have.
It is true. Do you think we have behaved ourselves during the lockdown, more or less?
I think a lot of us have. I would say a majority have. In fact, I was talking to my childhood best friend. I mean, that's an important term because the concept doesn't exist after you're an adult. And she's based in Atlanta, Georgia. And she said, you know, there are a lot of people in America, at least in her part of the world, that are actually following social distancing, but a significant number scoffing at the idea of it. Usually the young who feel it won't get to them. And also wanting jobs and the economy to get back on track. So I think I don't think that is a problem in India. In India, following the lockdown is a function of your socio-economic spectrum, really. I mean, people who have to go out and do stuff, they just have to go out and do stuff. They don't have the luxury of being at home.
Which is true.
So, which is also the case in America. I mean, people who actually cannot afford to sit at home, who are the ones who are actually on the front line. So I feel I think a significant number of people have actually been very cooperative in India. There are a few reckless ones which will always be around.
Yeah. What happened at the liquor shops? We saw that.
That's a lot of reckless people.
They were all in high spirits, even before consuming it. So also, what do you think about, you know, made in India? The emphasis should be on promoting our own industry, homegrown industries.
We've been talking about that for 6 years now. What's different?
True. But now the emphasis, they'd also need to put in funds to that. So give them that encouragement so we can, you know.
I don't know. I mean, I just think there are lots of great copy ideas, but I'm yet to see a tangible sort of, I'm all for Make in India. Absolutely. I mean, I'd rather not be having stuff which is imported. And I definitely believe in the spirit of Swadeshi as it was first envisioned. So yes, Make in India has been around for a long time. I'd like to see something done about it now. I mean, there's nothing new in Made in India or Make in India or Atmanirbhar. The lion and everything, you know, has been around for a while. It's time the lion began hunting.
True. Agree with you. And coming to Patal Lok, do you think it is very similar to the politics of our times, the times that we are living in?
Pooja, that is one of the primary reasons for me being drawn to the show. I mean, I'm a keen social, political, economic observer of our times. I feel that the kind of writing that we saw was quite incredible. I mean, the layering of the class conflict. And in India, there are a lot of factors to class. So typically in other societies, class is a function of economics. For us, class is a function of religion, of caste, and social background. And to see that depicted so well in this writing, I thought, it blew me away. I mean, the complexities of what simmers, and simmers is the operative word, Pooja. The complexities of what is simmering beneath the surface in India, but always threatening, but never boiling over.
True.
The sheer number of simmering tensions and conflicts that are there beneath the surface. This is a lot of them, and this show addresses quite a few of them. Of course, it doesn't make excuses for somebody being the way they are. I mean, you don't become an assassin just because of the background. But your background and your circumstances definitely play a huge role in how you turn out.
Which is true. And playing Renu Chaudhary, I don't want to divulge the plot for people who haven't seen the thing. What was it about her character? Also, do you look for yourself in the characters you play, a shade of you?
No, I think I don't do that consciously, Pooja. In fact, for me, so the primary reason was the manner of the layering in the writing. And the subjects. The other primary reason for me to be part of this was that I was getting to play a part that I haven't played in the recent past. So no matter what I play, be it a gangster, be it an intelligence officer, be it an upper middle class woman dissatisfied in her marriage or a protagonist, the word strong, empowered are always two adjectives that come with it. And also visually, my last few characters have been rather urban. So for me, the appeal of Renu's character lay in the fact that I hadn't played something like this in some time. I have, of course, played something very similar a long, long time ago in Manorama 6 Feet Under.
Mm-hmm.
And okay. This character is in parts inspired by the character of Manorama 6 Feet Under.
And what is it about you and thrillers? You seem to love thrillers.
I don't know. You know, I think, coming back to do I see myself in parts, I think acting is one of the things I do. And even though my acting career is an enabler of everything else that I do, there is a certain image that people have begun associating with me. And that determines their, you know, sort of casting decisions and stuff. So I don't really know. I mean, a lot of the parts that I've been reached out for of late have had shades of me in the part. I wasn't looking for those shades. I mean, ideally, I'd like to play something completely different. But that's how, I think Renu is one part that is completely, completely unlike what I've played.
And also, as I said, you and thrillers, and also a lot of content is being consumed on OTT platforms. Recently, exhibitors said that they're going to take retributive actions against those who are releasing their content on OTTs. The Producer Guild has come out with a statement. What do you think lies ahead of us? Do you think it's going to change the way we consume our films, our cinema? Because I don't know when the theaters are going to open. And do you also see the narratives are going to change and the stories that are now going to be told?
So two things. Retributive action, ultimately, everything is a function of choice. So the element of choice that is critical to all these decisions cannot be disregarded when you say that the exhibitors will get together and, you know, maybe have retributive action and all of that. Because force majeure has been invoked in every single contract that existed in the world. I'm not sure if there are any things that stand which would come in the way of act of God right now. That's as far as the legal position is concerned. Now, secondly, view of behavior is a very interesting thing. And OTTs, especially top of the pyramid ones like Amazon Prime, have a significant number of data points on our viewer behavior. So they know who is watching what and what people can be compelled or encouraged to watch. So now what's happening is also the theatrical model, Pooja, had to cater to a certain lowest common denominator, with no disrespect intended, had to cater to a certain lowest common denominator in terms of the subject in terms of the treatment of the subject and in terms of casting, because they were all a function of the return on investment. Now, with OTTs having the kind of data points that they have on our viewing behavior in terms of what we watch, and more importantly, what we don't watch, and also what they can compel us to watch and how we do get compelled and influenced by what is served. So they understand that puja exists and puja has certain viewing parameters. Then there's Gul, who likes romantic comedies and science fiction and thrillers and political dramas. So they know that there exists an audience for certain kind of content. And that helps them quantify how much of a certain kind of content should be made and what, you know, values are attached to it. Now, back to the lowest common denominator box. Because they can identify their audience and they know how to reach them, they can actually open the lowest common denominator box and A, choose different stories, and B, because stories would be sort of unique and, you know, perspectives would be unique, like in Patal Lok, there will also be unique casting choices and people who most suit the part. So I don't think anybody other than Jaideep could have played this part at all. Now, if this was a film, I don't know what decision maybe he would have still been cast.
True.
But that's not, I mean, I'm not the producer or the director who would make that decision, but I'm just, you know, I'm just encouraging people to think that it's not just the stories that are being sort of unboxed here. It's the casting choices, because casting choices are typically a function of the same LCD and ROI box.
Which is true.
And Jaideep is absolutely phenomenal in this. Absolutely phenomenal.
Which is true. But also, do you think post-COVID, the narratives are going to change? Because we are all not the same people.
So I think all of us are in the same storm. We could be in different boats. Somebody may be in a yacht, somebody could be on a cruise ship, somebody could be on a raft, or somebody could be hanging onto a barrel. So essentially, we're all in the same storm. We could, of course, be in different boats. And I think OTTs are here to stay, and the supremacy of the OTT platform was going to reveal itself in time to come. It's been hastened as a result of COVID. Also, keep in mind that while I do enjoy the experience, and I'm speaking only for myself, Pooja, I do enjoy the whole theatrical experience. But it does mean that I need to, I mean, again, I'm putting my own present situation. I have a 2-year-old. I have to make sure that I've either, you know, left him somewhere or I've got somebody to sit, to, you know, take care of him. Then rush, watch a movie. Making it for a movie is like making it for a flight. It's a lot of rush. Rush, and put so many things in place for everybody, I'm sure. So now I can watch stuff at my own time, which I'm not getting these days. And that's the irony. But I think consumer choice and the consumer is now at the center of the viewing game.
Yeah.
And the viewer is now at the center of the viewing game.
True.
It wasn't the case earlier. You decided it's Diwali. You decided it's Eid. You decided that they should watch this on Diwali and this on Eid.
True. Well, lots happening. You have your hands full. Doggos, a little baby, a toddler. How are you keeping fit? Because your fitness goals too.
So my fitness levels have never been better. I think I'm fitter today than I've been in, I'm trying to remember when.
You put up a picture of you when you won Miss India and wearing that swimsuit, and then recently saying I wear it better now.
Yeah, because I'm more confident in my body. Mm-hmm. Right, one, that's the thing. But I think I'm actually trying to remember. I'm definitely stronger than I've ever been. I mean, in terms of structure, I'm probably fitter now than I was 17, 18 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
There was a pure fitness and overall. I was one. And two, because I know I wake up in the day and I acknowledge the fact that today is going to be a challenge. The day I think, oh, it's a cakewalk, everything goes all right. So I know it's going to be a challenge, and I find little windows in the middle to try and exercise. And I make my exercise time very, very, very efficient. Sometimes my son will come and sit on my back. We'll do all kinds of things. I made videos of him trying to interrupt me as I do push-ups. But speaking of push-ups, I could barely do 10 military textbook. There are lots of varieties of push-ups which are comparatively easier to do. And I was doing the easier lot for a long, long time. And then I just figured that, you know, why not give it a shot? So I can now do 100 military push-ups, which I couldn't do when I started.
Awesome goals, you are.
Not in one go. But over three and a half sets. So how am I doing this? Simply because I know that if I don't do it, it's not vanity for me, it's sanity. Looking this way, it's just been a positive fallout. I mean, I didn't even notice this till I put on an old pair of shorts. But it's really about sanity. If I don't get this done, I will not be able to deal with the high pressure days. And pressure is not mental. Pressure is physical. Of just having to get so much done from morning to evening.
True.
I'm sure you're doing the same.
Yeah, I work out first thing in the morning. I work out, then I take on the rest of the day. What lies ahead?
I try to do the same thing. I mean, I have to feed a child. Otherwise, everything will go upside, topsy-turvy. But his breakfast, the moment his breakfast is done, I mean, that's usually coinciding with my cup of tea. I get it done. And it's usually, obviously, in the confines of our house. And one of us has to mind the child.
Oh, yes.
So, effectively, at any given point of time, only one person is doing any work.
Hats off to parents, as I say. Thank you so much. So, what can we look forward to post the lockdown? Then all of us will get back to normal life.
I don't know. I don't think normal is coming back for a long time to come, Pooja. I think that's that's something we should be cognizant of. And also, I think it's important. A lot of folks ask me this question, and you know, we've been in the middle of this PR blitz. And I'm very affirmative in my response that we're not going back to an old normal for a long, long time.
True.
And we should, I mean, I would say we would have to retain about 60% of our present time in our new normal. So what I'm looking forward to really is continue to better my present routine and structure, because I don't see this going away for a long, long time.
Which is true. And that's important. You can just improvise and live in the moment. Thank you so much. And I hope to see you soon as and when in person. But always a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you for your time. Thank you and good day.
Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much. Bye.